Firstly, I'd like to thank all of you for attending today, inshallah. My name is Ismail Kamda, and inshallah, the series of lectures which we have chosen to begin with the name Inspirations from the Righteous, starting with the life of Aisha bint Abi Bakr radiallahu anha. This series of lectures, we have chosen it because for many of us, we want to know about the righteous Muslims of the past. We want role models in how to deal with the issues facing us on a daily basis. But very often, these role models are not easily available. So, to get started today, I'd just like to lay down what I feel are the objectives of this program, because I think from the very beginning it's important for all of us to know and understand why we are getting together every Wednesday evening, what is the objectives, because if we don't have an objective, we can come here and we can have discussions every week and it might not really have any result. But if you have an objective, then we know what to work towards with each of our programs. So I also want this to be a interactive discussion, right? I don't want it to just come across as a lecture. So throughout the presentation, I will be asking questions, and the questions I'm asking will be of two types. Either questions which hopefully y'all can respond to immediately, and other questions are questions for y'all to go home and think about. Right, very closely related to our topics, thinking questions for us to go home and ponder over and come up with the answer by the next week, inshallah. Also, I want this to be a friendly environment. Okay, I'm very much for friendly environments, so smiling faces and interaction, and I want everyone to be comfortable. Okay, if anyone's feeling nervous, I'm more nervous than all of you, right? So from the very beginning, let's begin by going through the course objectives. And before I do that, I'd like to hear from anybody here in attendance as to what would you like to achieve from this, from these lectures on the life of Aisha radhiyallahu anha. Anything specific which you'd like me to talk about or which you'd like to learn about in the series? Anyone has any suggestions or any input? Nothing specific. Okay, as we go along, probably more specific topics will come up. From my side, there's four reasons why I wanted to have this program. The first is for this to be a weekly reminder for us all, to help us keep our iman levels high, to help motivate us, because on a daily basis, we deal with things which decrease our iman, which affect us, which affect our lives, affect our practice of Islam. By getting together once a week and talking about Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, talking about the righteous Muslims of the past, this helps give us what we call that iman boost. You know, that feeling of a recharge in our iman. And getting this at least once a week helps us to stay motivated for the rest of the week. A second reason why I wanted to have this program is for us to analyze the lives of role model Muslims, right? If you look at the history of Islam, the history of Islam is full of thousands upon thousands of role model Muslims, male and female. And I want us to go deep into their lives, deeper than we are normally accustomed to, analyzing their successes, analyzing their mistakes as well. And from both, extracting lessons which are relevant to our lives, to the contemporary world that we are living in. So this is, I think, to me, the most important aspect of the series, that what we get out of this should be lessons relevant to our lives. So when things happen in our life, we can relate back to Aisha or any of the other role models that we discuss, and we can take a lesson from them. The third motive behind the series, the third objective, is to clear up any misconceptions about Islam and Islamic history. Right, particularly with the life of Aisha radhiyallahu anha, there are a lot of misconceptions. There's a lot of issues which people pick on. We find this from both Muslim and non-Muslim alike. Can someone name me one aspect of the life of Aisha which is controversial? The age when she got married. Yes, very controversial issue, and we will come to that inshallah probably in next week's lecture, right? But that's something which I want to discuss for at least half an hour to give a comprehensive picture, because this is something which a lot of non-Muslims ask about and a lot of Muslims also have doubts about, right? Aisha radiallahu anha, according to Sahih al-Bukhari, married Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam when she was 9 years old. Growing up in the Western world, this sounds very strange, right? So this is definitely a contemporary issue and something which we want to discuss in details. And inshallah, we'll get to that either later today or in next week's lesson, inshallah. So that's one controversial issue. Anybody know of any other controversial aspects of her life? Yes? Yes, the accusation. Yes, the hadith of ifk, the accusation of zina labeled by the hypocrites, right? A third event in her life which is very controversial is what is known as the Battle of Jamal, the Battle of the Camel, when Aisha led an army which ended up clashing with the army of the Khalif at that time, Ali ibn Abi Talib. Very controversial issue. We will get to it inshallah as we go along in the upcoming weeks. So one of the reasons I chose Aisha radiallahu anha specifically is not only is she a comprehensive role model of a true Muslim, but there are many aspects of her life which keep cropping up in the modern world, and we really need clarification on these issues so that we can put our own hearts to rest and that we can educate others as well. And the third, or rather the fourth and final objective for having the series is to provide us with role models of people who were rightly guided. Now, we all recite Surah Fatiha in our Salah. And in Surah Al-Fatiha, we make the dua, اِحْدِنَا الصِّرَاطَ الْمُسْتَقِيمِ صِرَاطَ الَّذِينَ أَنْعَمْتَ عَلَيْهِمْ. Guide us to the straight path, the path of those whom you have favored. In another verse of the Quran, Allah explains who are those who He has favored. He said those who He has favored are the Nabis, the Prophets, the Siddiqs, the Shuhada, the Martyrs, and the Salihin, the Righteous. So four types of people are favored by Allah. The second category is what concerns us here. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said He favored the Siddiqs. Which Sahaba had the title of Siddiq?
Abu Bakr.
One other Sahaba also had this title. Who? His daughter Aisha. Aisha was known as Siddiqa bint Siddiq, the truthful woman, the daughter of the truthful man. So by studying the life of Aisha, we are studying the life of a Siddiq. By studying the life of a Siddiq, we are studying the life of one of those whom Allah had favored. And we are studying the life of someone who was on Sirat al-Mustaqim. So if we want guidance to Sirat al-Mustaqim, we will find that guidance in studying her life. So this is the fourth and the final objective from my side as to why we are studying these topics. I'd like to begin with a quotation from Abdullah ibn Mas'ud about why the Sahaba are important to us. Before I do that, can someone tell me who was Abdullah ibn Mas'ud? Abdullah ibn Mas'ud gave us a very important quotation about the Sahaba. Why does what he say about the Sahaba matter? Anyone know this name, Abdullah ibn Mas'ud? Think about it. Okay, let me just summarize Abdullah ibn Mas'ud's life for you in about four lines. Abdullah ibn Mas'ud was the eighth person to convert to Islam. The eighth person to convert to Islam, according to some narrations. Other narrations still mention him amongst the first few people to convert to Islam. He was one of the leading tafsir scholars amongst the Sahaba. One of the leading tafsir scholars amongst the Sahaba, and he lived a very long life. So he was there from the very beginning. From the very beginning, when Rasulullah ﷺ began spreading his message of Islam, Abdullah ibn Mas'ud was there. And he was there right till the end. After Rasulullah ﷺ passed away, beyond that, he was still alive teaching the people. So he witnessed the entire period of revelation. So much so that he said that I know every verse, when it was revealed and who it was revealed about. Because he was there from the beginning. So what he is telling us about the Sahaba is based on his life experience. Being one of them, living with them, knowing all of them on a personal basis. He says about the Sahaba in a very beautiful quotation. He says, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala looked at the hearts of His servants. And He found that the best of hearts was the heart of Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So he chose him for himself and made him his final messenger. Then he looked at the hearts of the rest of the people who were on earth at that time, and he found the hearts of his Sahaba to be the best hearts on the face of this earth at that time. And so he chose these people to be the Sahaba of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and he chose them to fight for the deen and to defend the deen. So whatever they believe to be good is good in the sight of Allah, and whatever they believe to be evil is evil in the sight of Allah. This narration of Abdullah ibn Mas'ud summarizes for us why the Sahaba are important. They were chosen by Allah. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala could have sent Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam to any community in the world at any point in time, but he sent him to Makkah 1400 years ago to that specific community and surrounded him with these specific people. These people were chosen by Allah to be the companions of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And so if someone was chosen by Allah, that means that their life is very, very important. So we understand that the Sahaba's lives are very important, and one hadith which sums up the importance is the hadith of the best of nations. Qala Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam khayrul quruni qarni thumma alladhina yalunahum thumma alladhina yalunahum. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said that the best of nations, the best of generations is my generation, and then those after them, and then those after them. And then after those three generations, there will come a time when the Muslims will be obese and they will love obesity. Very interesting hadith. But what concerns us here is the first part of the hadith. The first part of the hadith, which is the best of generations is my generation. Meaning, if you want to know what is Islam, right? You are confused. You know, you see 100 different types of Islam being practiced in your community. Everyone says they're right, everyone else saying no, you're wrong. How do you know right from wrong? What did the Sahaba believe? What did the Sahaba practice? What was the Sahaba's understanding? Why? Because they witnessed the revelation. They learned directly from the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. They were chosen by Allah to be his companions. So definitely their understanding of Islam is the best understanding. And so the first three generations of Muslims, the first generation is called the Sahaba, the companions of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, or another translation, the disciples of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. The second generation is the Tabi'in, Tabi'i, which means the successors, the second generation. And the third generation is called the Atba'a Tabi'i, which means the successors of the successors. To make it easy, all three are put together as one title, which is the Salaf, or the Salaf As-Salihin, the righteous predecessors. So when people talk about the Salaf, they are referring to the Sahaba and the two generations after them. So these three generations of Muslims are very important. And from these three generations of Muslims, if there's a clash between these three, the Sahaba are most important, because the Sahaba understood Islam best. So that is why we chose the Sahaba. So then the question comes up, you know, there are hundreds of Sahaba. Why did I choose the life of Aisha radiallahu anha from all of the Sahaba to discuss? I gave one of the reasons earlier, the controversial issues related to her life, but there are other reasons as well. For me specifically, one of the reasons I chose Aisha radiallahu anha is that from the female Sahaba, she is one whose life has been documented in the most details. The amount of narrations about the life of Aisha radiallahu anha are too many for us to count. Really, the more I'm researching, the more and more narrations I'm coming across on her life. It has been documented in great details. Not only has her life been documented in great details, but she was a very successful woman in a variety of different areas. She was a successful wife. She was the daughter of a righteous woman, a righteous man and woman. She was a scholar of hadith, a scholar of fiqh, a scholar of tafsir. She was a teacher. She was a mufti. She was a mujtahid, a person who could make their own fiqh opinions. She was a leader of an army at one point in time. She was involved in the politics. She was an advisor to the caliphs. We are talking about one of the most accomplished women at a time when literally across the world, women were oppressed. You know, we're talking about 1,400 years ago. We know in the Western world, until World War I and World War II, women were oppressed. That's only not even 100 years ago. But 1,400 years ago, Aisha was able to accomplish all of this. So when we look into her life in details, you see a woman who has accomplished things which most men are unable to accomplish. And so you get a comprehensive role model of what is the rights and the role of a woman in Islam, and how does a woman, a Muslim woman, go about living her life. And of course, the lessons from the life of Aisha apply to both men and women. A second reason why I chose her life is I find in the English language, we lack resources on the female role models, right? Alhamdulillah, there are many, many wonderful books and lecture series, and now even TV series on the lives of the male Sahaba, right? Umar radiallahu anhu, Abu Bakr, Usman, Ali, the Ashra Mubashara, Khalid bin Walid, huge book on Khalid bin Walid available. All of the male Sahaba, a lot of it is available in English. But for some reason, I have found very few books in English on the lives of the female Sahaba. And those few books which I have found are very, very brief. For example, one of the books I was reading on the life of Aisha, radiallahu anha, covered her life in about 20 pages. And really, if you just read the her biography in Ibn Kathir, just her virtues, you know, her accomplishments in life, that itself is 4 pages in Arabic, which in English would have been about 10 pages, right? But to go into details of all of her life story, at least 200, 300 or 400 pages you can write on the life of Aisha. So why is it that the only thing available in English is 20 pages? You know? So this is something which bothered me, that we have in the Arabic books like Bidayah wa Nihaya and all of these other amazing books of Islamic history, we have thousands of pages on the lives of the righteous women of the past. Really, thousands upon thousands of pages. But when we open the English books, we are unable to find that many. So this is your question that I want you all to think about, and not answer now, but think about it for a week. And the question is why? Why? In Arabic it's available. Why is it not available in English? So inshallah, go home later and think about that. Why is it that we don't have these resources in English? What could be the possible reason behind it? So today, inshallah, being the first and the introduction lesson to the life of Aisha radiallahu anha, I want to focus today on what is customary when starting the life of a righteous person, and that is her fada'il, her virtues, her list of accomplishments. In the classical Arabic books on the lives of righteous people, usually the first chapter is dedicated to the fada'il, the virtues of that individual. And this, the purpose of this is that it serves as a taster. It serves as something to get you excited and interested into studying that person's life. Because when you go to the person's virtues and accomplishments, you just want to know, who was this person, you know, that reached such a high status? So you become more and more interested in that person's life, that you are now ready to sit for hours on end and study that person's life. So following that tradition amongst the Muslim scholars, I would like to today focus on the fada'il of Aisha radhiyallahu anha. And there is an entire chapter in Sahih Bukhari on the fada'il of Aisha radhiyallahu anha. And the 4 hadiths which I'll be discussing today are taken from that chapter in Sahih Bukhari. So whatever hadiths I will be discussing today are authentic hadiths taken from Sahih Bukhari in the chapter on the virtues of Aisha. But before we do that, I want to begin with the description given to Aisha radhiyallahu anha in Bidayah wa Nihaya by Ibn Kathir. Ibn Kathir, very famous scholar, many of you might know his name from his book of Tafsir, Tafsir Ibn Kathir. He's famous for writing two books. Two books of his are very famous. One is his Tafsir, which most of you are familiar with, and the other is his history book, Bidayah wa Nihaya. Bidayah wa Nihaya is one of the most comprehensive and amazing history books ever written. And it gives the whole history of the early Islamic Empire. And so in every year, he gives a brief biography of the righteous people who passed away that year. And so in discussing the year when Aisha radiallahu anha passed away, usually his biography of a Sahabi is about 4 lines or half a page. The biography he gives of Aisha is 4 pages. Right? Remember, some of the major male Sahaba, he discusses the biography in about half a page. But with Aisha, he gives a 4-page description of her biography and her virtues. And I just want to quote you the opening lines. Ibn Kathir says, from amongst those who passed away in that year was Ummul Mu'mineen, the mother of the believers. Aisha binti Abu Bakr As-Siddiq. Aisha, the daughter of Abu Bakr As-Siddiq. Zawjatu Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, the wife of the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and the most beloved of his wives to him. Al-mubarra'atu min fawqa sab'a samawat. She was the one whose chastity was declared from above the seven heavens. Radiyallahu anha, may Allah be pleased with her. He then goes on to describe her virtues in the next four pages. Now, just to break down what he said, he begins by calling Aisha Ummul Mu'mineen, the mother of the believers. Can someone tell me where do we get this title from and why do we give this title to her? Anyone knows why do we call Aisha the mother of the believers? You're married to Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, yes. So where does the title come from? Who made it up? What you're saying is true, but that's not where the title comes from. Actually, you won't believe this. A lot of people don't know this. You know, because most of the time the titles we give to our righteous predecessors is made up by someone, right? Someone called him Imam, somebody called him Sheikh, somebody called him Allama, whatever it was. But the title Mother of the Believers comes directly from the Quran. Suratul Ahzab, chapter 33, verse number 6. Suratul Ahzab, chapter 33, verse number 6. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, the messenger is closer to the believers than their own selves. وَأَزْوَاجُهُ أُمَّهَاتُهُمْ. And his wives are their mothers. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tells us in Suratul Ahzab that the Messenger of Allah is closer to the believers than their own selves, and his wives are their mothers. So from this verse in Suratul Ahzab, where Allah declares the wives of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam as our mothers, from this verse we get the title Ummul Mu'mineen, the mothers of the believers. This title applies to every wife of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. When we talk about Hafsa, we say Ummul Mu'mineen Hafsa. When we talk about Salama, we say Ummul Mu'mineen Salama. For any of his wives, we call them the mothers of the believers. And this title has a spiritual application and it has a fiqh implication. The fiqh implication of this verse is that after the death of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, it was not permissible for anybody to marry his wives. His wives remained unmarried until they passed away. Now, Aisha radiallahu anha lived for approximately 50 years after the death of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and she was only about 18 or 20 years old when he passed away. Which means from that age until the age of 62, she remained unmarried. Right? It's not permissible for someone to marry their mother. It's not permissible for the believers to marry the wives of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So that's the fiqh implication. The spiritual implication is the level of respect and love we are supposed to have for the wives of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Because think about it, in the family structure in Islam, the person who has the highest level of respect and love is the mother, right? The hadith of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, when the Sahaba asked him, who should we obey most after Allah and His Messenger, he said, your mother. And then the Sahaba asked, and after that, he said, your mother. And after that, again, he said, your mother. And then he said, the father. Meaning that the mother has, you know, this is for emphasis, that she has three times more right over you that you obey her. So if our biological mothers have this rank and respect in Islam, our spiritual mother, the mother of the believers, the wives of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, the level of respect and love we are supposed to have for them is even more. And this is why I say it is very, very important, if not compulsory upon us, to learn their lives. Because you cannot love someone who you don't know. We can claim to love Aisha radiallahu anha, but if you don't know her life, I mean, what exactly do you love? You know, if you know her life story, maybe you love her knowledge, her intellect, her self-confidence, you know, her outspoken nature, you know, how she dealt with fitna. You have something specific to love and to look up to. So this becomes a motivation to study their lives, that these are our mothers. And it is our duty to know the lives of our mothers, to understand them, and to follow in the example. So she was known as the mother of the believers, Aisha binti Abi Bakr As-Siddiq, the daughter of Abu Bakr As-Siddiq. Right over there, in her name, is one of her virtues. She was the daughter of Abu Bakr. Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu was the greatest man to walk the face of this earth after the prophets. This is the belief of Ahl Sunnah wal Jama'ah. Abu Bakr was the greatest man to walk this earth after the prophets. The closest friend of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, if I had to take anybody as a Khalil, as my closest and best friend, I would have taken Abu Bakr as a Khalil. You know, Khalil refers to that specific friendship where you listen to everything they say. Of course, Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam would not take someone to a level where he listens to everything that they say, but what he's indicating is that his closest friend from amongst humanity is Abu Bakr. Abu Bakr was from the Ashara Mubashara, the 10 who were given the glad tidings of Jannah. And Abu Bakr was the first Khalif of Islam. And it was in the reign of Abu Bakr that the Quran was compiled into one Mus'haf. And Abu Bakr was Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam's companion in the cave. And Abu Bakr was the first man to convert to Islam according to many narrations. So imagine growing up in the house of Abu Bakr. Imagine being the daughter of Abu Bakr. And right here we learn a lesson. The power of parenting. Very often I have many parents tell me that, you know, if we raise our children Islamically, they're not going to appreciate Islam because they never experienced Jahiliyyah. So this becomes an excuse to let the children experience Jahiliyyah. And I say to them, history proves you wrong. Because Aisha was raised in a house of Islam by righteous Muslims. She never had a Jahiliyyah period. Aisha never had a Jahiliyyah period. Right? She was raised in a Muslim home. She was born into a Muslim home. And even before Islam, Abu Bakr never worshipped idols or did any of these things. He was a righteous man even before Islam. That was what an amazing person he was. And she appreciated Islam and became a leading scholar of Islam. It was the same with many people after her. Imam Ash-Shafi, raised by a single mother, a righteous woman. She raised him up, he became a leading scholar of Islam. Right? Umar bin Abdul Aziz, the revival caliph amongst the Umayyads. He was raised by righteous parents. Right? If you study his biography, he's a fourth generation of righteousness. His great-grandfather is Umar radiallahu anhu. You know, his grandparents was the son of Umar radiallahu anhu and the righteous woman. And then his parents were Abdul Aziz bin Marwan and the granddaughter of Umar radiallahu anhu. Fourth generation of righteousness. Umar ibn Abdul Aziz did not have a Jahiliyyah period, you know, to make him appreciate Islam. He appreciated Islam from day one. And this is something I find throughout history. When you study the lives of our heroes throughout history, very often they were people who were raised by righteous parents. Very, very often. Imam Malik, raised by righteous parents. Imam Shafi, raised by righteous single mother. Imam Bukhari, we know the story of his mother and how she made dua for him and encouraged him to study Islam. We know the lives of many of the righteous people. So parenting makes a difference. And we see it not only in the life of Aisha, but even in the life of other members of her family. Because Aisha radiallahu anha, she had an older sister who was also a righteous and famous person. Who was the sister of Aisha? Asma binti Abi Bakr. Asma binti Abi Bakr was another amazing woman. A very, very brave woman. If you look at Asma when she was young, and her father and Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam were making the hijrah to Medina, she was the one who secretly went out to give them food. We're talking here about the two most wanted people in the land. You know, if you're caught assisting them, you can be killed. You can be tortured, you can be harassed. And here we find her going out at night to meet them and to give them food. Bravery. Abu Jahl comes to her house looking for her father. And she stands up to him. He slaps her in the face. She still doesn't give away her father's location. Courage and bravery in the life of Asma. When she becomes old, many, many years later, Asma radiallahu anha, as an old lady, blind, old and blind, her son Abdullah ibn Zubayr was leading a rebellion against Hajjaj ibn Yusuf and the Umayyads, and he's about to die. He's about to lose the rebellion. So he comes to his mother and he tells his mother he's thinking of surrendering. Mind you, his mother is in her 60s or 70s and she's blind. And she shouts him for thinking about surrendering. And she tells him to remove his armor. You know, she hugs him and feels the armor, and she tells him to remove the armor and tells him a martyr does not wear this. And so he went into battle and he was martyred. And the ruler of that time in Makkah, Hajjaj ibn Yusuf, was a very tyrannical man. Most of the men were scared of him. But Asma herself went up to him and demanded that he gives Abdullah ibn Zubayr's body back to us so she can bury Hassan. So we see Asma radiallahu anha as a very, very brave and courageous woman. And she too was the daughter of Abu Bakr. And she was approximately 10 years older than Aisha. So that means she was Aisha's older sister. Now, psychologically speaking, we know that most young girls, when they are between the ages of 6 and 9, their role model is their big sister, right? So that means Aisha is growing up with Abu Bakr as a father and Asma as a big sister. So imagine growing up in that environment. What level of righteousness is this woman going to reach? Where her father is this amazing man, her mother Umm Rumman is an amazing woman, we'll discuss her in a few weeks time in one of the stories we come to inshallah, and her sister Asma is another amazing woman. She's growing up in this home of absolutely amazing righteousness. So we see parenting and the importance of older siblings being good role models in the life of Aisha radiallahu anha. So the description Ibn Kathir gave to her, he called her the wife of Rasulullah and the most beloved of his wives to him. The wife of Rasulullah and the most beloved of his wives to him. Now, how many wives did Rasulullah have? Another controversial issue that the non-Muslims bring up. 9. No. He had 9 when he passed away. 11. 11. 2 of his wives passed away during his life. When he passed away, he had 9 wives. Right? So, Ibn Kathir is saying from all 11, Aisha was the most beloved. There's actually a difference of opinion amongst the scholars on this topic. Besides Aisha, who else could have been the most beloved? Khadija. So this actually becomes an issue of debate in the books of Aqidah. I was actually reading a book of Aqidah recently, and there's an entire section in the Aqidah book, did Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam love Aisha or Khadija more? And the end of the discussion, after giving both opinions, the author of the book, Sheikh Al-Usaymin rahimahullah, he mentions that it doesn't matter. It doesn't matter if you loved Khadija or Aisha more, because they are both in Jannah, as are all these other wives. And that's what matters. Right? What matters is that they all went to Jannah. They all went to paradise. That's the goal of a Muslim. The goal of the Muslim is not to earn a human being's love, to be the most beloved person to another person. The goal of the believer is to go to Jannah, to go to paradise. And so he ends the discussion by saying that whether he loved Aisha more or Khadija more, it doesn't matter. It's not the important issue. The important issue is they went to paradise, they are our role models, and we have to follow in their footsteps. So those scholars who say that Aisha was the most beloved, the hadiths we're going to look at later, which indicate this. And the hadiths which indicate that Khadija was the most beloved, because Aisha herself said that she never got more jealous of anyone than Khadija. Because even like a decade after Khadija had passed away, Rasulullah would still think of her and remember her and talk good about her and even keep good relations with her friends. You know, this was the level of love he had for Khadija radiallahu anha. So that became an issue of debate. At the end of the day, it's not an important debate. It's not something which matters. And the lesson we can take from that is something which the Quran itself teaches us. And that is, when you are studying history, focus on what matters. Focus on what benefits you. Very often these days when we study history, we want to know, or we, especially when we teach our children, we ask our child, on what date was this Sahabi born? Or what date was that Sahabi, or did that Sahabi die? Right? We ask them these questions. Who was so-and-so's grandfather? You know? What kind of tree did Adam alayhi salam eat from? These are things that don't matter. What you should actually be teaching and learning and teaching our children is, what do I learn from the life of Aisha? What do I learn from the story of Adam and Shaitan? How does this impact my life? How does this make me a better Muslim? This is what the focus of stories are supposed to be on. So we take a lesson from this, that when we study history, we avoid the things which have no relevance to our lives, and we focus on those things where we can extract lessons and practice them in our own lives. So Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he loved Aisha radiallahu anha the most from his wives. How do we know this? We will come to that in one of the narrations later on. The final description that Ibn Kathir gave to her is, he called al-mubarra'atu min fawqa sab'a samawat, the one whose chastity was declared from above the seven heavens. The one whose chastity was declared from above the seven heavens. This is referring to the incident the sister mentioned earlier of the slander of Aisha, where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala himself defended her honor in Surah Nur. And inshallah, we'll have an entire lecture just focusing on that event. Because that's a very important incident with lessons very relevant to contemporary society about gossip and about slander and about all of these issues coming to play. So inshallah, we'll dedicate an entire lecture just to discuss the Hadithul Ifq, the slander against Aisha radiallahu anha. So this became a title of honor for her, that she was the one whose chastity was declared from above the seven heavens. And therefore, anybody who accuses her of not being chaste, such a person is a disbeliever, because they are going against the verses of the Quran. Allah is saying one thing and they are saying something else. So that is what Ibn Kathir had to say about her. Let's go to the most important person, Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam is the most important person here, on one hand because he is the messenger of Allah and he speaks from revelation, on the other hand because he was her husband. So he knew her best. So what does he say about her? In Sahih Bukhari, there is a chapter on the virtues of Aisha in which four hadiths are mentioned. The first hadith, narrated by Amr bin Al-As radiallahu anhu, he says that I once asked Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam, who is the most beloved person to you? And Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam replied, Aisha. So Amr said, I mean from the men. Who is the most beloved of people to you from the men? And Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam replied, her father. Right. So this hadith is in Sahih al-Bukhari. Now there's actually a background to that hadith. Amr bin al-As radiallahu anhu, he was one of the leading non-Muslim figures in Makkah in the early seerah. Right. He was a person who, we would say, he had a very eloquent tongue. He was a very smart talker. He knew what to say, when to say it, how to say it. So he was like the spokesperson of the disbelievers until he converted to Islam. And then he became one of the main leaders of the Muslim army. So when Amr bin Al-As converted to Islam, he found that Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam would treat him very, very well. So Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam was treating him so well that he began to think, maybe Rasulullah loves me more than anybody else. So let me ask him who is most beloved to him. So when he asked Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam who is most beloved to him, and the name Aisha came out, Amr said, I meant from the men. I'm not talking about love for your wife, that sort of love. I'm talking about brotherly love. Love from the men. And he still said, her father. So there's so many lessons we can take from this hadith. The first is this hadith confirms without a doubt that the Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he loved Aisha and he loved Abu Bakr. Right? Abu Bakr, we said, was his closest friend from the Sahaba. Aisha was his closest wife. So this hadith confirms for sure both of these points. A second point we can take from this hadith is that it was publicly known that he loved his wife. Something which many men today regard as embarrassing, right? They regard it as something dishonorable or something unmanly to tell someone that they love their wife. And that's against the sunnah. The sunnah was the Sahaba knew. Rasulullah sallam loved Khadija. They knew he loved Aisha. In fact, Anas ibn Malik said, he said that the first true love that we experienced as Sahaba was the love between Rasulullah sallam and Aisha. Right? Anas ibn Malik, by the way, he was a youngster. He lived in the house of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam from the age of 10 till the age of 20, serving Rasulullah sallam and working for him. So he was able to observe how Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam was with his wives, because he was working for Rasulullah in his house. So he makes this observation. He says that the first love that he experienced, that he saw, was the love that Rasulullah had for Aisha. That was when he saw for real what is love. What is love between a husband and wife in this relationship that Rasulullah had with Aisha radiallahu anha. A third lesson that we can take from this hadith is that the wives of Rasulullah and the early Muslim women were known publicly by name. They were known publicly by name. And I mention this because nowadays a lot of people say that a woman's name should not be made public, right? She must be completely anonymous, right? They even say it's against her honor or against haya for people to know her name. And that's not true, because if you look at the Sahaba, not only the wives of Rasulullah but even the other Sahaba, we know their names. We know the names of the female Sahaba. We know the names of the next generation of women as well. Right? If you look at the students of Aisha, we know them by name. Right? Many of the female scholars throughout history, we know them by name. So this idea that women are not supposed to be known by name, this is not from Islam. This was added in much, much later on. Because anytime in the early aspects of our history, you do find a name. If you read Sahih Bukhari, he narrates hadith, Imam Bukhari narrates hadith directly from women. He quotes them by name, that so-and-so lady told me this hadith, and she heard it from this person, and she heard it from that person, or he heard it from that person. They are mentioned by name. So the names were known. It wasn't something which was people were ashamed of or felt that they needed to hide. So this hadith is again evidence of that. He didn't say, I love my wife. He didn't say, I love Abu Bakr's daughter. He said, I love Aisha. He mentioned her by name. Right? And the fourth lesson we take from this hadith is a lesson in manners and etiquette and how we deal with people. Because Rasulullah dealt with the Sahaba in such a way that every Sahabi felt they were most beloved to Rasulullah. So much so that Amr bin al-As, who was a late convert to Islam, he felt he was the most beloved. He felt he was most beloved because this is how Rasul dealt with people. You know, even though there were so many Sahaba he loved more, but this is his, he didn't show favoritism in his dealings with people. He didn't show favoritism. If Abu Bakr was there and Amr bin al-As was there, he wouldn't treat one like you special and you low. No, everybody felt like they're the best. So this teaches us manners. How do we deal with people? Deal with people in such a way that everybody feels loved. Everybody feels cared for. Everybody feels that, you know, you like them. Don't treat people harshly. Don't treat people meanly. Don't chase them away from the deen. So that is the first narration found in Sahih Bukhari about the virtue of Aisha. The second narration is a very, very beautiful narration. Again, Sahih Bukhari. And this narration is narrated by Aisha herself. Aisha radiallahu anha, who is the fourth greatest hadith narrator. The fourth greatest hadith narrator amongst the Sahaba. She narrated over 2,000 hadiths. And this is one of the hadiths that she narrated. Aisha says that one day, Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam told her, Ya Aish, O Aish, Jibreel is here and he is conveying salams to you. So Aisha radiallahu anha replied, Wa alaykum as-salam, wa alaykihim as-salam, wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. May the peace, blessings, and mercy of Allah be upon him. You can see that which I cannot see. This hadith is truly beautiful because, firstly, imagine being told by the Prophet of Allah that the angel Jibreel is giving salams to you. I barely know of any Sahabi who this happened. It happened to Khadija as well, by the way. Even Khadija, Jibreel once came and conveyed salams to her and gave her good news of a house in paradise where she won't have to do any work. You know? So we see this with Khadija, we see this with Aisha, that Jibreel himself conveyed salams to them. So if Jibreel himself conveys salams to her, this means that she had a very high ranking in the sight of Allah. You see what it means? Because Jibreel is not just going to convey salams to anybody. Right? So that's one thing we can take from this hadith, is her rank in the sight of Allah. And I just can't imagine the feeling of knowing that the angel conveyed salams to you, subhanAllah. Another interesting or more finer point from this hadith, and you find this in many of the hadiths where Rasulullah and Aisha are conversing with each other, he calls her Aish. Many hadiths, he calls her Aish. And in some hadiths, he calls her Humaira. Humaira, there are many translations. The translation which makes the most sense to me is the one with red cheeks, the one with rosy cheeks. Right? Because she was very young and very beautiful and she had blushing cheeks, right? So he wouldn't always call her Aisha. No, he would call her Aish. He would call her Humaira. He had pet nicknames for his wife. And this is something you'll see in the life of Rasulullah, especially when it comes to his dealings with Aisha and Khadija. His romantic side shines through. You find a lot of romance in these narrations, really. When you see Rasulullah's interactions with Aisha, they are very romantic. So yeah, even when he's talking about the angel Jibreel, he calls her Aish. Right? He calls her Aish instead of Aisha. So this is the second hadith, which truly establishes her ranking in the sight of Allah. That she is someone who even the angels conveyed salam to. The third narration is a long narration, but we'll just mention the part narrated about her. Abu Musa al-Ash'ari narrates that Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, "Fadlu Aishati ala nisa ka fadli sarid ala sa'iri qu'am." The virtue of Aisha compared to all other women is like the virtue of Sarid compared to all other food. Sarid was the name of one of Rasulullah's favorite foods. It was like one of the best dishes you could get in Arabia at that time. So saying, if you compare this dish to all other food, that's Aisha compared to all other women. That's her rank in the sight of Allah. That's her rank in Islam. You know? And again, this is part of a much longer hadith where Rasulullah says that from amongst the women who attained perfection, were Fatima and Maryam and Asiya. And then he says, but the virtue of Aisha over all other women is like the virtue of Sarid over all other food. So again, the scholars differ. Does Aisha have a higher rank than Fatima or not? And the scholars say she does not. Why? Because Rasulullah ﷺ said that Fatima is the leader of the women of paradise. So once he says she's the leader, that means she has the highest rank. Right? So Aisha will come after Fatima in rank. But compared to all other women, Aisha is the best. So this narration, we learn from this about other women whose lives are worth studying. Who was Asiya? A woman who attained perfection. Who was she? The wife of? Fir'aun. The wife of the worst man. One of the worst men to ever walk the face of the earth. His wife was one of the four greatest women to walk the face of the earth. A woman who Rasulullah says she attained perfection in her iman. And Maryam, the mother of Isa alayhi salam, Jesus peace be upon him, also a woman who attained perfection. And Fatima, and another narration adds in Khadija as well, right? And then Aisha. So we learn from this narration that Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam regarded Aisha as amongst the top five women to ever walk the face of this earth. The top five women to ever walk the face of this earth. Fatima, Maryam, Asiya, Khadija, and Aisha. These were like the top five. So this, we're not talking about just any woman here. We're talking about in the history of humanity, one of the absolute best. One of the most highest ranking imaginable. And the final narration, the fourth and final narration, again, it's a very long narration. I'm going to go into it in more details in a later lecture, inshallah. But just to mention it very briefly, and we'll conclude with this for today. Once the wives of Rasulullah were having a dispute, so they sent Fatima to argue on their behalf with Rasulullah, right? Because we know Fatima was, again, we said she was one of the greatest women. She was also the daughter of Rasulullah, and she was also someone he had a very soft spot for. So if she said something, he would listen, right? So she came and she asked Rasulullah to spend more time with his other wives besides Aisha. Again, we'll discuss this narration in more details in a later lecture. But basically, she was talking about Aisha. So Rasulullah gave Fatima a very interesting reply. He told her, "Oh Fatima, do you love that which I love?" And Fatima said, "Yes, definitely, I love what you love." So Rasulullah pointed to Aisha and said, "So love this woman. Love this woman." Meaning, Rasulullah loved Aisha, so therefore the Sahaba must love Aisha, and therefore we must love Aisha. Now, again, remember, Aisha's relationship to Fatima was that of what we would call today a stepmother, right? She's married to her father, and she's younger than her, or around the same age as her, right? Now, we know nowadays, if your father has a wife around the same age as you, that's normally a cause of friction. Rasulullah tells Fatima, love her because I love her. So again, this narration clearly establishes the love of Rasulullah for Aisha, and it clearly establishes that we are also supposed to love her because she was beloved to the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So with that, inshallah, we come to the end of the chapter in Sahih Bukhari on the virtues of Aisha radhiyallahu anha. These four narrations are mentioned there, and this gives us a taster of what's to come. This gives you a preview that if this woman was so beloved and this woman was so high rank in sight of Allah, in the sight of Rasulullah, what did she accomplish in her life? So we will begin next week by looking at her marriage. When did she marry Rasulullah? What was the background behind the marriage? Why did he marry her? What's up with a 9-year-old getting married? You know, how do we explain this? You know, why did Rasulullah have 9 wives? You know, because we know that's not allowed for average Muslim man. Why was it allowed for him? How do we explain this to non-Muslims especially? And also some fiqh principles that we can extract from the story. right? Because from the marriage of Rasulullah to Aisha, we can actually extract very important fiqh principles that we can apply to the contemporary society. So we'll discuss the marriage of Rasulullah to Aisha in the next episode, and then we'll move on to other issues after that. I want to end with a quotation from Aisha's nephew, Urwa bin Zubair. Urwa bin Zubair was one of the scholars amongst the Tabi'in. He was the daughter of Asma, he was the son of Asma and Zubair bin Awam, and he wanted to study Islam. So his father told him, if you want to study Islam, study with Aisha. Because he had a very big advantage over other men. Aisha was his auntie, meaning Aisha was his mahram. Meaning the other men who wanted to study with Aisha, there was a hijab between her and them, and she's teaching them from behind the hijab. But with Urwa, no hijab, that's his auntie. He's her nephew. So he could study with her on a very close level, and he could interact with her in a way other men can't. For example, in one of the narrations, Aisha narrated that Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam used to kiss his wives before going for salah. So Urwa told her, "That must have been you." And she started blushing. Of course, no other man can tell her that, but because they're mahrams, he could talk to her in this way, right? So he developed a very close relationship with Aisha radiallahu anha as his auntie, and he was one of her students. So he says about her, and this is what we'll close with. Urwa says, "I did not see anybody," he didn't say any woman, he said anybody, "I did not see anybody more knowledgeable in fiqh, medicine, or poetry than Aisha." I did not see anybody more knowledgeable in fiqh, medicine, or poetry than Aisha. And there is no woman or man other than Abu Huraira who narrated more hadiths than her. Right? Now when we list it, she comes as number 4 in hadith narrators, but this was his perspective. Right? In another narration, he goes on, he asks Aisha, he says, "Oh Aisha, I know why you know fiqh, why you know hadith, why you know poetry, but how do you know so much about medicine?" And Aisha said, "When Rasulullah was in his final illness, I learned medicine so I could look after him." So this is Aisha, an absolutely amazing individual and one of the greatest Muslims to walk on the face of this earth. And that's why the scholars, when they used to narrate hadith from her, they used to say that Siddiqa bint Siddiq, the truthful woman, the daughter of the truthful man, Habibatul Habibillah, the beloved of the beloved of Allah, Al-Mubarra'atu min fawqa sab'a samawat, the one whose chastity was declared from above the 7 heavens, she narrated this hadith to me. That was what they would call her. So we will end with that for today, inshallah. And next week we will continue, and we will look at her marriage to Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and the issues surrounding that, very important contemporary issues. Before we conclude, are there any questions or comments? Okay, inshallah. So again, if you have any feedback at all, you can send us the feedback. Let us know what topics you want us to cover. Let us know if there's anything we can improve with the presentation, inshallah. Because we are